If you think back to the 1960s racing scene, one event immediately comes to mind. The Le Mans 24 Hours. At the height of its international popularity, the annual event saw the now iconic battles between Ford, Ferrari, Porsche with its early models of the 917, Lola, Chaparro with the 2D and 2F. But perhaps the most beautiful car of this era was one that never had the opportunity to compete, and as a result, has largely been forgotten. It is this, the Jaguar XJ13. From the early 1950s, Jaguar had been interested in developing something new for racing purposes. Utilizing a new type of dual overhead camshaft engine in a V12 configuration. Jaguar had been heavily vested in the racing scene for a long time, and likewise were no strangers to trying their hands at experimentation. By the early 1960s, the racing scene began to shift. It looked, although it was finally time for the ideas floating around from the past to come to fruition. The man behind the concept was William Haynes, who had dreamt up a new breed of race car, perhaps capable of racing flat out at the legendary 24 Hours of Le Mans, that would utilize this new type of V12 engine. Haynes, who was working as Jaguar's director of engineering, had put the idea to paper in 1960, and after 4 years of waiting, in 1964, a team was assembled. Malcolm Sayer, a Jaguar veteran who had worked on legendary designs such as the C-Type Racer, and eventually Jaguar's most iconic car, the E-Type, was brought on board to help design the exterior of this new concept racing machine. During the Second World War, Sayer had worked in the aircraft manufacturing industry, learning the ins and outs of aircraft fuselage design. Many years later, he applied for a job at Jaguar, and in the years that followed, he proved himself to be not only capable of designing beautiful cars, but ones which were fast. His experience working with aircraft led to him adopting a highly mathematical approach to car design, applying his own mathematical formulas to maximize aerodynamic efficiency. His drawings rarely contain lines, but rather many-dimensional points in a type of three-dimensional matrix, drawn in a manner similar to that of old aircraft designs. One could then take these reference points and mark them on plywood, cutting out the pieces and assembling them atop a piece of marked paper. It was truly like building a World War II fighter. The XJ13 was to be no different. It was to be made of aluminium and take aerodynamically successful and visually beautiful elements from previous iconic Jaguars and blend it together into something uniquely different and modern. To translate Sayer's design into a reality, an expert team of engineers would be picked by Haynes. Among them was Bob Blake, a self-taught panel beater from the United States, who had, throughout his childhood, dreamt of building race cars. Following military service in World War II, he began making car bodies, and throughout the 1940s, established a name for himself. And through a series of lucky connections, would find himself working on cars that would indeed race at Le Mans. Briggs Cunningham was racing Cadillacs at the 1950 Le Mans competition and needed someone to upgrade the existing designs of these cars at the location. And it was Blake who did the job, staying up 48 hours before the event began, working on this. The car, which during the race following a terrible start, pulled off an impressive comeback, climbing from 35th to 11th place, despite losing both its first and second gears. Cunningham, who was impressed with Blake's work, would have him build his own cars to race at Le Mans for the next 5 years. And following the short-lived success of his company, Cunningham would call Blake one of the best welders and formers in America, having built all of Cunningham's cars almost all by himself as well. This would later lead Blake to working for Jaguar. And just like Sayer, he would play a part in the design of some of their most iconic cars. Using Sayer's unique mathematical drawings and Blake's superb ability to realize them, the team got to work building the car. Using a bunch of makeshift methods to help translate Sayer's aircraft-inspired designs, the magnesium monocoque was built within a plywood frame, as the team's surface table simply wasn't large enough to fit it. And, as the story goes, following several years of development, The car emerged in 1966. The result was perhaps Jaguar's most beautiful car, but only one would ever be made. Although the car fit with its contemporaries of the time, such as Ferrari's 330 P4, its soft design was something else, setting it apart visually from the cars it was made to compete with. In some ways, the design mirrored the German masterpiece of the 1930s, the Auto Union Type C Streamliner, a 520 horsepower V16 experiment which dominated the racing scene of the time. So well engineered, it was capable of 320 kilometers per hour, and that's in 1937. The car would cease production in 1942, as Germany's war with Russia would end up consuming all manufacturing power, and, like the XJ13, would sadly be forgotten. Last-minute changes to racing regulations in 1966 meant that the XJ13 would never race at Le Mans. Requirements stated that concept cars could have engines with a displacement no larger than 3 litres. The only way around this was to qualify as a production car, which meant at least 50 had to be built. But by this point, the 5-litre V12 engine was thought to be obsolete against the new 7-litre V8, similarly streamlined car Ford had been racing. Nevertheless, in early 1967, racing driver David Hobbs, under instruction from Jaguar, took the car for a spin around the MIRA track. The results were great, the car hitting speeds of over 250 kilometers an hour and setting a new lap record. Sadly, for the designers who had taken the project seriously, the concept was never a real priority for Jaguar as a company, and the car soon found itself locked away in storage for many years to come. Eventually, the car would re-enter the public spotlight in a promotional move to draw attention to a new model of the E-Type in 1971. But unfortunately, it would suffer a serious crash, which almost completely destroyed the vehicle, and the wreck was once again put into storage. It would not be till later that the wreck was found, somewhere in a Jaguar storage warehouse, and using surviving drawings from Sayer, a rebuilding process was attempted. Although the car would not retain its original appearance, it was close, and that was enough. So now, here we are, slowly closing in on 60 years since the creation of perhaps the most beautiful car Jaguar has ever made. It's easy to forget something which never got to prove itself against its now iconic counterparts, but the elegance of this is what has carried it through the years in the minds of a select few enthusiasts. As time goes on, the price of this vehicle will undoubtedly rise higher and higher. And as it gets higher in price, the less it will see the road. But ultimately, it's invaluable because it's more than a car, an assemblage of soulless metal on an endless production line of clones. It's something truly unique. The last of its kind from an era of handcrafted ingenuity, which we'll likely never see again. It's a testament to art, beauty,